This is an evil individual.
Tonight at 10, exclusive and new insight into the murder of a Loranger mother and kidnapping of her two daughters.
We're gonna just fight for them. You know, fight for the justice for them.
We've been demanding answers and looking for solutions.
A lot of people are asking what happened with this case.
WDSU investigators Aubrey Killian and Cassie Sherm teamed up on this investigation to look into what could have been done differently.
We start with Aubrey, who has been digging into the potential red flags that were missed.
Mm-hmm. Through the cracks.
New Tangipahoa Parish Sheriff Gerald Sticker speaking with WDSU Investigates about Daniel Callahan.
I have agreed to not fight it.
He admitted to murdering Callie Burnett, then kidnapping her daughters, taking them from Loranger to Mississippi. One survived. Callie's daughter Erin was found murdered.
Hindsight being 20/20, I mean, obviously we wish that we could have identified him sooner and made that arrest sooner. But that did not happen.
Let me take you back to May of this year. Callahan is accused of arson and theft of a firearm. Then June 10th, right before the murders, criminal damage to property and unauthorized entry. Video shows Callahan naked and appeared to be armed with a crossbow in Tangipahoa Parish.
Had he been identified, then I'm sure he probably would have been incarcerated.
You have Callahan on video committing these crimes days before this unfolded. We've got fingerprints from previous arrests. Why were we not able to capture him in those crimes?
The answer is I can't speak to the specifics of it. I don't have full knowledge of that. I know that the report was taken. It was assigned to the detectives, the investigations division, but the connection was not made until the homicides came to light.
June 12th is when the sheriff's office says the Burnett family reached out to a family member who works for the sheriff's office. 911 was called. Deputies then responded.
I think they tried to ping her phone. They tried to search her license plate and the license plate cameras to see where, you know, she may have been. So when finally, that I think it was past that 24-hour mark, closing in on the 48-hour mark, is when the father went back over to the mobile home, and that's when he discovered, and I think he forced entry into the mobile home.
Callahan and his alleged accomplice, Victoria Cox, now facing capital murder, kidnapping, sexual battery charges. Cox allegedly helped Callahan kidnap the sisters and bring them to Jackson.
He plots, he plans, he schemes, period.
Dixie Hempel is Callahan's sister.
Callie and her family are the victims.
Absolutely.
What do you want them to know?
Know that your babies are actually angels themselves. They're heroes. I honestly believe in my soul that my brother would have hurt more people if he wouldn't have been caught this time.
WDSU Investigates went through hundreds of court records. Tangipahoa deputies say Cox had no major arrests with them. But here's never-before-seen video from May of 2023. A call came in about Victoria Cox being suspicious at a Dollar General. She was gone by the time law enforcement arrived, and I'm told there wasn't enough to take her into custody. But for Callahan, it's a different story. Multiple arrests throughout the parish. Court records show crimes from 2006 to 2010 in Tangipahoa Parish. We uncovered a document that states Callahan stole Xanax in 2009. And another court record, it states he was going to burn the trailer down while his mother was sleeping in 2008. And this record, from 2009, shows him asking a judge to spare him with probation so he can take care of his sick mother. Making a vow, I will stay out of trouble and drug-free. Please help me in any way possible. I won't let you down. Court records show multiple charges were dismissed. But then fast forward to 2022. Callahan is arrested in Lincoln County, Mississippi. Records show he was accused of sexual battery of a minor. The sheriff's office says in 2023 a grand jury did not indict him due to a lack of evidence. The sheriff's office responding to our public records request stating that a justice court warrant was issued in June of 2022. Please contact the court for a copy.
These are the type of situations that could change things. The way that systems are, or the way that towns work, or protecting children in the future.
We contacted the court for a copy, and we even showed up. We were told it wasn't going to be released to us while we were there. They did give us the warrant days later, but without the details that we requested.
They should be able to, I would think so.
Lincoln County District Attorney Brendan Adams.
Do you think the public has a right to know why this happened?
I believe in being very transparent with the public and making sure that I can make our community aware of what is going on inside of our community. As far as I know, like I said, the previous administration did a full investigation of this case and it was presented to the grand jury. Why the grand jury chose not to indict is not something that I can speak to.
And back in Tangipahoa Parish.
What can you assure the public that you are doing to prevent this from happening again?
Looking at training across the board for patrol, our corrections deputies, looking at our detectives, and that there's oversight, that every complainant gets a phone call back.
Sheriff Sticker says he's for the death penalty in this case. And as for Callahan's own sister.
Do you think your brother deserves the death penalty?
Yes, I do.
Tonight, our WDSU team investigation reveals issues within the statewide Amber Alert system after a Loranger mother was killed and her two daughters were kidnapped.
WDSU investigator Cassie Sherm walks us through those precious moments and the changes that are on the way.
Could it have been life-saving? I wonder if it could have been different.
Callie Burnett's sister, Brandy Hosh, is talking about the almost four-hour window it took between the time when Callie was found murdered in her home and her children missing to when the Amber Alert was finally sent out.
It certainly didn't help that it went out so far past when everything was found. I guess we'll never know.
WDSU looked into the minutes and even seconds of what happened that morning on June 13th, and we found there's a shocking number of steps to get an Amber Alert sent out in our state. An after-action report looking into the Amber Alert shows the first moments after Callie's body was found. At 8:37 a.m., a lieutenant with TPSO sent an email to a state employee about their investigation into a homicide where the woman's children were missing. That email was not seen for 34 minutes. That's because the state employee was out of the office for training. At 9:21, TPSO was instructed to fill out an Amber Alert application. 17 minutes later, LSP emailed a Word version of that application to TPSO. The lieutenant, though, could not access the forms. The website link was then sent. At 10:18 a.m., TPSO sent the request for an Amber Alert. 7 minutes later, that Amber Alert request had to be forwarded to yet another state employee before it could be looked at. 5 minutes later, the state said the application did not include the suspect's name, correct date of birth for one of the children, and a license plate, so it was considered incomplete according to state police. Now, WDSU Investigates noticed the form does not specifically ask for the license plate, and the date of birth for the younger sibling was off by 1 year. A minute later, LSP tells TPSO the alert would be issued as a level 2 endangered child, not as an Amber Alert. But according to TPSO's timeline, when Chief Jimmy Travis asked an employee with the state if the department needed any additional information, they were told, quote, no. These take a lot of time as there's a lot to vet. Then at 11:46 a.m., state police receive information from an eyewitness observed the victim's vehicle with two children, an adult male and two adult females. 42 minutes later, the Amber Alert was then sent out almost 4 hours after they found Callie's body. Later that afternoon, one child was found murdered in the woods while the other was abandoned in a car near Jackson, Mississippi. We reached out to state police for an interview, but were told at this time they will not agree to talk until they talk with the family. They did, though, meet with TPSO.
We both agreed jointly that there needs to be training, ongoing training, and it needs to be ongoing communication between the two agencies.
TPSO Sheriff Gerald Sticker gives us a better insight of what both departments say went wrong.
Number one, communication between the two agencies at all levels. And number two, the training component and making sure that training is ongoing so that everybody is on the same page.
In the past 22 years, only 21 Amber Alerts have been issued in the state of Louisiana. Some parishes have never had to go through this process.
We need to make sure that everybody is trained and prepared and ready to respond, so we're not trying to learn about what we should be doing when the call comes in. And unfortunately, that's the case in some situations.
Janelle Rasmussen is the director of the federally funded Amber Alert Training and Technical Assistance Program.
Here we host a national Amber Alert Symposium. Ironically, this year it was in Louisiana and New Orleans.
One of the main trainings she says can be requested is CART, which stands for Child Abduction Response Teams.
We develop these teams within the states, and then we train them, and then we certify them.
There are 131 CARTs in 32 states.
So for like Louisiana, is there different law enforcement agencies that have that accreditation?
There are currently no agencies within the state of Louisiana that are CART certified. If an agency requests a CART training, we'll send a team at no cost to go out and do the training.
The ununified response to the murder kidnapping has caught lawmakers' attention.
It looked like there were some discrepancies or some inconsistencies of what was being reported. Who talked to who, when, and what time. Then the back of your mind, you're always thinking, could we have done something better?
Baton Rouge Representative Dixon McMakin now believes Louisiana's Amber Alert system needs an overhaul. He sat down with the governor and state police to talk about solutions.
We went through it step by step, not only this case, but all the cases. What happens, how it looks, because we know, we saw in this case, how important every second, every minute is.
McMakin is focusing on the first step, which is Amber Alert forms. Right now, just to fill out the form, you have to go online, download the document, fill out the information, save it, and send it back.
Our modernization task force will look into is, you know, a direct uplink with a notification that says, we've received it, here's the person that is reviewing it, here's their number, we have your number, the person that's filled it out. We're now going to be in constant communication.
Currently, it's up to individual states to have their own forms, softwares, and even methods.
Something we've taken away from this case is to say national standards, national guidelines are good, but Louisiana can be better.
Do you think that something could have been done?
It's tough to say what could have happened in this case. We will never know. I don't think we will ever truly know what we could have done better to maybe save that life. But I know in the future we're committed to making sure that we can be as efficient and effective as possible.
Even though the clock ran out for Callie's youngest girl, her family still has hope.
We've seen that, and we definitely appreciate that. You know, for the next family, unfortunately, that has to use Amber Alert, we don't want that to happen to them. And we miss them. We love them. It's not just a story.
And that was a team investigation with Cassie Sherm and Aubrey Killian.
To see the full timeline, more videos from law enforcement, and read about our investigation, go to WDSU.com or the free WDSU app.